All right, here we are, 2014 Pro-Am Summer League at the Downtown Rec, August the 10th. We are coming to a close of a great summer of basketball, and I have with me today the supervisor of this opportunity, the Orlando Pro-Am, Sheldon Oliver. Sheldon, tell me about the year. What's it been like?
This year has been a lot better. I think a big improvement from last year. We got a lot better teams, so it's a lot of closer competition.
If there was one thing that you would say that made this year different from last year, from a competition standpoint, what would that be?
I would say a lot younger. We got a few younger players, more college athletes, athletic, very athletic teams. So, you know, and that on top of, you know, just playing with a lot of pride and some bragging rights. So. Mm-hmm.
Now, this opportunity here, we've had some NBA players involved, am I right,
mm-hmm.
this year as well. Had less teams than we had the year before, but you're saying with better competition than the year before.
Exactly.
Or it's been good competition for the number of teams.
Right, exactly. Better competition. I think it kind of equals out. So what happened is a lot of the teams combined, gotten mm-hmm. together, you know, kind of got rid of some of those bottom feeder team. So,
well, I think too, here's the thing that we find important. What do you think about this matchup that we got here? Are you surprised by the two teams that are involved, and what's your expectation for the game?
For one, I'm kind of surprised about one of the teams in particular. It's just the game before, mm-hmm. they were down late in the game and they end up coming back and hitting the game winner, so that was a big surprise. My expectations and for the game, probably, honestly, I don't have a winner.
Okay, you don't have a winner.
But I expect a good game.
Yeah.
I really expect, too,
we're going to have I think it's going to be a closer game than we might imagine. Mm-hmm. Now, from moving this thing from, we had it over, it was over at the Smith Center, and now we moved it over here to the Downtown Recreation Center. What's the advantage of that to you?
Some of the advantages, it's a bigger facility. I think it's meant for NBA games, mm-hmm. nicer crowd. Just like anything, some of the disadvantages is just kind of new place, getting yeah. people to recognize where we're now holding the games, but I think it's coming around.
I'm really excited about what's about to happen. So, again, you can check this game out today on U Central Sports. And please go and take a look at it. Again, Sheldon, thank you.
Thank you.
And, hey, good luck tonight for a great game. Thank you very much. Here we have one of the semifinalists, or the finalists for the day's game, is a three strike. This is Coach Juan. Coach, tell me about your last game, which was the semifinal game to get you to today's game.
Well, it was our second game of the day after our quarterfinal, and got out to a slow start, especially defensively. That first half, we just didn't guard anybody. And I told them, control the flow of the game, and we contest shots in the half court and rebound and finish plays. Fortunately, we were able to slow them down, and we figured out the right lineup that was the best way to attack them. And we were able to claw back in the game little by little, and it gave us a chance to win at the end. And fortunately, Pat Ewing Jr. hit a gigantic shot to send us here to the final.
Yeah, I was surprised that he took that last shot, but he had a great look, a great situation, but I didn't think he was going to be the one to take the shot. Now, coming into today's game, what's your anticipation of what you're going to see this afternoon?
Well, loyalty. These guys are the three-time defending champions,
yes, they are.
And they are for a reason. They're very versatile. They got an alpha dog who can get any shot he wants at any given time, and Dominique Jones. Obviously, the key to the game is going to be stopping him. But even more so than that, we have to contain their other guys.
Yeah.
Dwayne Foreman, for them, their point guard, he does a great job getting mm-hmm. them shots. And we're going to have to contain him defensively as well. And they have some size that's very active,
yes.
In that middle that we're going to have to keep off the glass. So if we can keep them off the glass and control the pace of the offense with our discipline, I feel like we have a really good shot to win the game.
Should be an interesting game, but I also want to make it known, this is not your first time at the Big Dance. Now, did you not win this one year?
Yeah, 2009 we won it. In 2011, when they won their first, when Loyalty won their
right.
first
you
championship,
were,
they beat us.
They
so
beat you.
We feel like they owe us.
So this is like a revenge game.
Yeah, we feel like we owe them one, but we're gonna have it's gonna be a total team effort on our end. We have eight guys, and we're all gonna play a lot of minutes and contribute. And we just want a chance to win it towards the end of the game. And hopefully, our discipline and execution will be a little bit better than theirs down the stretch.
Well, it should be an interesting game. Great matchup, I think, too. I think they, as you mentioned, both of you got an advantage here, and they're just going to be depending on. My take on the game is always on the defensive side of the ball, how well you play the defensive side. Yeah. Any game strategy going in that you can talk about?
Yeah, I mean, obviously all I'm going to tell our guys is, look, I don't care about offense in the early part of the game. Offense will figure itself out. It's going to take you a little bit to get your legs under you. But defensively, we've got to get back and make things difficult for them. That entire first half of that semifinal game, we spotted them a 19-point halftime lead because we made everything easy for them.
Right,
and
sure
they did a great job of taking advantage of making it easy. You know, they didn't make it harder than it had to be. But when we got back and we focused defensively, possession by possession,
yes,
we were good. And that was what was able to come back for us and win the game. Now, that's something we're going to have to do for the entire 36-minute-plus possible overtime duration of this game for us to win.
Talk to me about the fact that you just finished playing and you've got about an hour and a half rest between your last game, and they've got somewhere maybe it's close to 3 hours rest. How much of a difference? Now, there's an advantage and there's a disadvantage. What's your take on that?
Well, we knew coming in that we had to have win three games, and I managed the minutes accordingly to where we're not really tired. We may be a little stiff, but I don't think fatigue's going to be an issue. Listen, when you have to win a chance to win a championship, you're going to go out and win it. It's not about X's and O's at this point. It's about will
and
determination and pride.
Absolutely.
And who wants the bragging rights until next year's Pro-Am.
Well, we're looking forward to it. It should be an interesting. I wish you a lot of luck and look forward to the game, and thank you for spending some time with us.
All right. Thank you for having me.
Okay, Vince, want to talk to you briefly. You need to do the intro for us. This is the championship game. The teams are?
The teams are Three Stripes and Loyalty. Loyalty is a three-time Pro-Am champion.
Right.
In fact, the guy that's coaching them, that they told me last year when he walked off the court that he was finished.
Right. I remember that. Yeah, right.
Well, I saw him mid-season, and he said, I got called back. And I said, hey, you got to come home when they call you. You got to come back home.
Right.
So hopefully he's going for his fourth opportunity, and this would be Three Stripes' second opportunity. In fact, when they lost last year, they lost to Loyalty.
Okay.
So it's kind of like they're feeling like, hey, we got to get back in it. This would be their second one if they got their opportunity to win. So it should be a good game.
Okay. Now, earlier I heard a conversation, and it sounded like they really shouldn't be here. People are surprised that they are in the championship game.
There is a little bit of surprise. They're playing against a team out of Tampa, the Graham Brothers, and they were up by 19 at the half.
Wow.
And these guys, Three Stripes, took their time, which I didn't believe. I honestly was doubting them myself. But they walked this thing down to entire the game, and with seconds on the clock, Patrick Ewing Jr. took a shot here from the corner and made it, put him up by two, and they won the game at the buzzer. So we're a little shocked, especially at a 19-point lead, that they would be here. But that in itself is going to probably create a lot of excitement, I believe, about what's going to – then you got two teams who have played each other before.
Okay.
Lost, 1-1. They're back on the floor again, bragging rights on the floor.
Okay, well, let's go back to the team from Tampa. The fact that they were up by 19, were they really that good, or did the other team play that bad?
I actually think they are, without a shadow, they were my favorites to win.
The team from Tampa
was my favorite to win.
Okay.
They had the best record. They lost a game yesterday, which kind of put them in second place, but they were still the favorite. I really think, quite honestly, they lost focus.
Okay.
They let the momentum of the other team take over the team, and they couldn't get it back up.
Okay.
And these guys got some good shots. There were a couple of calls here that I think that went their way.
Okay.
That gave them advantage, opportunity to get a basket here and there. And to their credit, when they got the opportunity, they took full advantage of it.
Okay. Well, won't you just rewind and kind of go and bring us forward to the start of the season of the Pro-Am to where we are now?
We started this year in June 28th. mm-hmm. on a Sunday mm-hmm. at our first games. And what we found about this season, as Sheldon was talking about earlier, we had less teams than we've had in the past. We normally okay. have 12 to 14 teams, mm-hmm. but we had eight teams. And what the advantage of that, we found that these eight teams were very evenly matched, very okay. competitive. Had one team that was at the bottom, always someone has to be at the bottom. But we've had very competitive games. They've been very close. The today's game with a big halftime lead, but ending up with a close, is symptomatic of what we've seen all season long. Okay. So what we're excited about is there seems to be some balance.
Okay.
We don't have one team that's heavily favored. We've had several of these teams early on had NBA players, but today's final will be no NBA players.
Okay.
So we're gonna go back to the roots of their teams and get okay. down and make that happen.
Okay. Why don't you give us some of the names of the NBA players that we might recognize?
Let's see. Well, we've had Nick Calathius has been in. Chandler Parsons has been in. Dominic Jones is playing overseas. He's a former NBA player. Patrick Ewing playing overseas, former NBA player. We've had about two other guys that have come in. Pat Calathius, he was here. He's a former player. So we've had a lot of those guys. And Austin Rivers came in and played. O.J. Will, most people, well, White Chocolate, they called him, used to play at University of Florida, played for the Magic, was here for a while. So we've had a nice group, but because some of these guys were unsigned in their contracts, some of them played on the USA team, they're not available now. But this is one of the reasons we wanted to try to move the championship games up so that they would be available. But this time it worked out that for whatever be the reason, they're not here. But I don't think it's going to make a big difference because we've got some overseas players out here, some guys that really know the game. This should turn out to be a pretty good game.
Okay, now for those who know very little about the Pro-Am or may be watching for the first time, why don't you kind of give us the rules, and this is basically built off of the NBA?
Absolutely. This is the NBA format. We got a okay. three-point line. We got a table with a shot clock, scorekeeper, and a bookkeeper. Mm-hmm. We've got NBA officials. We got NBA officials, NDBL officials, and Division I college officials. Guys, in fact, we had two guys who moved up from this league over the last 5 years just got pulled up to the NBA to be an NBA official. Okay. We have a certified trainer in the house. We have coach teams. It's NBA ball at a local level that I think is fantastic for the community, because where else can you go and see this level of play? This is not rec basketball. Okay. This is real from Division I players to JUCO players, overseas players, that you can come and see it for free.
Well,
right in your community.
Well, you know, between you and I and knowing what we know, whenever there's anything to do with anything, when it's time to play, it doesn't matter.
It does not matter.
It's like when it's time to play, it's time to play. And when that saying is, if I show up, I need to show out.
That's exactly right. And that's what I'm looking for today. I think you're going to loyalty, having been here before, will come in mm-hmm. with that proverbial chip on their shoulder. This mm-hmm. is mine. This is okay. You got to take it from me. Okay. Three strikes, feeling like, okay, I lost this to you last year. Mm-hmm. Here's my opportunity to get it back. Okay. It would be fantastic, and I don't have a favorite.
Right.
But I'm just looking toward next year to be what would the champion look like next year if one of these guys were to win tonight. If three strikes won, I'm sure loyalty would want to come back next year. So a great rivalry. This has turned into that kind of a competition that I think has been really good for the community.
Oh, okay. Well, you brought us up to date. How long has this been going on here in Orlando? How long have you been doing this now?
What? Now, we've been involved for the last 7 years. This okay. has been going on for at least 15 years prior to us being here.
Okay.
And it's 20-plus years that the program has been going on. We've got involved, like I said, about 7 years ago, and brought some different structure to it. We kind of cleaned it up a little bit in that there are no players under 18 allowed to play. You have to be out of high school. And we have certified officials. We have certified trainers. We tried to make it as professional as we could because we want the NBA players to come and feel comfortable, the Division I coaches that would allow their kids to come and play, whether it be Division I, II, or III. So we were just trying to up the level of competitiveness and quality, not only for the people that participate, but for the people who are watching.
Okay, now, give us some names that has played in the Pro-Am that's been part of here in Orlando. Just throw out some names.
You've had Darrell Armstrong, Big Baby Davis. You've had Vince Carter. You had Tracy McGrady. You've had Chucky Atkins, Bo Outlaw, Nick Anderson, Courtney Lee. That's just to name a few. I mean, we at one point in time, we've had several of the NBA players come through. Chandler Parsons has been through. Nick Calathes has been through. We've had some excellent ball players come through and play, which I think is added to the quality of the game itself.
All right. Well, can't wait for the tip-off. And you say you don't have a favorite. I mean, you're actually not.
I don't have a favorite at this time.
Well, you know, from what I've heard, there appeared to be an underdog from what I've really been hearing. But according to, you never know. But there is an underdog.
There was an underdog, and I think right now you would have to say that three stripes. It would have to be the underdog because Loyalty won last year. They're the defending champ.
Okay, if they're the perfect storm, then there's a chance.
There's always a chance. always a chance.
Charles Morris along with Vince Carter bringing you up to date on the Pro-Am here in the downtown rec here in Orlando, Florida, 2014. We're going to take a quick timeout, and we'll be back with more from right here at the downtown rec. Happy to have you with us.
That's what helps us put this on. Again, here we are at the Downtown Rec 2014 Pro-Am Summer League Championship Game. I'm very pleased to have sitting with me right here our booking official, NBA official Eli Rowe, and I'm excited to have and spend some time with Eli. Eli, I know you were just out in Vegas at the USA program for a while, and how's that looking?
Everything was looking good out there. I actually refereed the Summer League. Not the USA basketball, NBA Summer League out there in Vegas. And they drew really well, the highest crowds they've ever drawn. And, you know, basically most of those players are, you know, either young players that just got drafted, and a lot of them are guys that aren't even on teams. So to see that much fan participation was really exciting for the NBA Summer League.
Now, Eli, you've been involved with us over for, the last 6 years in this program?
I think it's been about 9 years now, Mr. Carter.
Give me some idea of what you've seen over those last 9 years, from then to where we are today.
Well, definitely the talent has picked up every year. Obviously, we have, you know, NBA players that play with us every year, and we also have some guys that play overseas. In Europe and other pro leagues, whether it be in Puerto Rico or whatever, that come and play. And the talent level every year is picked up. And I think that's just been a word of mouth thing, because I think a lot of the players have talked to their friends and guys that maybe live out of town and told them what a good thing we're doing here, and guys have come over to join this pro-am.
Now, we've had, I think just last year, we had two guys that were moved up. Up to the NBA. Talk about that for a minute.
Yeah, that's another thing I wanted to tell you about. In addition to the talent level with the players being on the rise over the last 9 years or so, we've also had a lot of talent level in the referee ranks that have been rising up through this pro-am. We had two hired into the NBA last year, and there was only two hired, and they were both from Orlando. Mm-hmm. And we also have about five guys right now that are on the D-League staff, and we're hoping maybe some of them can be hired into the NBA over the next 3 or 4 years. So things have really been taking off in Orlando and in the Orlando area. We've got a lot of guys that work NBA basketball or in the D-League.
And I think that's one of the things I think people miss. There might be a slight misconception. The idea of the pro-am is obviously for players to hone their skills, but I think people don't understand this is about officials honing their skills as well. Would you agree?
Yeah, this is big for officials because we don't get a chance to work a lot of pro ball, especially for younger guys. If they're not in the D-League and maybe trying to get in the D-League, there's no other pro ball opportunities than pro-am. All they can do is work their college and high school schedules during the season, and they don't have any experience on how to handle the pro rules, how to handle grown men, how to handle the pro mechanics that we use. So this is their one chance to do it. So that's why I get so many people that are interested in working this league, and I have to turn a lot of people down. I have to just look for the cream of the crop, because there's a lot of people that want to come referee this league because they know how good the talent is and they know how professionally and how serious we take this.
That's a compliment to the area. Now, how long have you been officiating?
Well, I've been officiating total for about 21 years. I've been in the NBA for 9 years, just finished my ninth year. So I've been a diehard ever since I had a chance. 18 is when you can start repping, and I took the opportunity to do that immediately.
Now, just like we've seen changes with players from a talent level, do you see the same thing with the officials that they're coming along? Because the game itself is changing, which is causing the players to make adjustments. Same is true of the officials?
Yes, definitely. We are under a microscope now more than ever. It used to be in the past that the games, they didn't have all the cameras that they have now. They'd maybe have two or three cameras to cover the games, and they wouldn't show a lot of replays and stuff. And now, generally when ESPN or TNT has a game, they might have 14, 15 cameras with all sorts of different angles. And the officials really have to do a better job of getting plays right, where in the past, it was a little more about managing the game and making sure that the coaches and the players weren't getting too upset, or you didn't have fights that occurred, and they would realize, okay, they're going to miss some plays. But we're kind of out of that area, that era now. Now we're in the era of getting plays right, because we are under such a microscope. So instead of trying to keep teams happy or coaches happy, you know, because it's a blowout or whatever, we just have to try to get plays right all the time.
I think all that goes to what making the game a better game, because the game is younger than it was at one time with a number of players. And do you see the skill level being the same, or is that diminished, or is it increasing?
I think the skill level has improved as far as players' ability to jump and run and be stronger. But as far as like guys shooting outside or some of the fundamentals, I would say those, to me, have kind of stayed the same ever since I got into the NBA about 9 years ago. Seems like that aspect has kind of stayed the same, maybe even gone down a little as far as shooting. But the talent level, as far as the athletic ability of our players, I think goes up every year.
Well, we're looking forward to a long relationship and getting ready for next year. We've already started some conversations about that. We're getting ready to get this started. And I just want to say, on behalf of the Midnight Basketball team, we greatly appreciate your association with us. And I think your involvement has really helped raise the level of this program as being seen not only in the community but around the country. And we greatly appreciate that.
Well, I really appreciate it, Mr. Carter. And I really enjoy working with you guys and look forward to every year.
Girl, we look forward to having you. Thank you so much.
Vince, do you know who the starting fives are?
Oh, well, let's see. We got for the three stripes. See, you've got Kyle Matthews. We've got Brandon Richardson, Patrick Ewing Jr., who is number 7. We have Alex Castillo. That's the starting five that's coming out on the floor now. Pretty good group too. Of course, you got Patrick Ewing Jr., a young man that obviously played a little NBA ball. He's playing overseas right now. As far as team loyalty is coming out, they haven't put their guys out there yet, but I'm sure they're going to start Dominique Jones. He's a former NBA player, played at Lake Wells High School, University of South Florida.
Yeah, actually, you know, I think last year we was calling him Mr. Jones.
Mr. Jones, I anticipate that he'll be Mr. Jones again. I think, and then we got Wayne Former, who played at Georgia Southern, and he's played overseas, played in Cyprus for a while.
Uh-huh.
So, let's see, they got Yusef Baker, a local guy, played at Evans at high school and also played at University of South Florida. Good matchup on there. And then you have, let's see, I need to see his number, though, so I can just get his number correct. Sean Taylor, went to Jones High School, Brevard Community College. Quick little point guard. He playing against Dwayne Former should be very interesting. Great matchup.
Okay. And we start off with Mr. Jones.
Bobby Brown, 12. All right, here we go. We got our first tip-off here. Ball in Dominique Jones' hand, which I anticipate that ball to be in his hand a lot tonight.
And he makes it look easy.
All right, here we are looking at a obviously man-to-man defense with a little motion. Got a mismatch on B. Rich. They call it number 12. Patrick Ewing. And this young man here, number 2. Alex Castillo, local favorite. Played at Lake Howell High School. Young man has definitely improved his game a lot.
Going the other way. No, actually staying here.
Staying right here. This should be interesting. Going into this, again, we got the thing that we're looking at is that loyalty, three-time champions, and the fact that when they won last year, they won against this team for the championship.
Aggressively going at the basket. That was a good block.
Nice recovery. Nice fast break. Push the ball up real quick. Got ball out, turnover.
I think that might be our first turnover of the game.
One of the things that you can look forward to, too, is that Loyalty finished their game about 4:30, so they've had about 3 hours off.
Let me ask you something. How do you think that affect the players now when you have to play more than one game on a day? You know, is that something that they're used to?
Normally you don't do that.
Right.
I think that's not something, especially at this level, that you get. But if they played, you know, obviously these guys have played AAU ball and stuff, and that's multiple games a day is the norm. But one of the things here, we try to give them some time off so they can recoup. We're going to tell what kind of condition they are and whether or not they will be able to keep it up.
Right.
And I think you see evidence of that right now going into the game. The condition of the game right now is a little slow.
See, the funny thing was, back when I played, I never thought about playing more than one game. It wasn't until I was much older that it came into mind. Like, oh, wait a minute, you're playing more than one game in one day?
Yeah, I think that kind of comes to mind at that time.
Because back then, it'd be like, oh, can we play 5 or 6 games? Yeah, sure. No problem.
I know that feeling. Dwayne shooting 2, made his first basket. Missed the second. I scored early on, 3-0. And Large was up.
And it looks like they're trying to
Alex Castillo
push
on an inside basket.
That's twice they push that ball up the court.
Push the ball up pretty good. It gets up the floor. I like the pace of it, that they get it up the floor real quick. Dominique Jones against Alex. Nice move, Patrick Ewing coming in.
Nice.
Basket.
Nice.
Fast break ahead of Patrick, one on. He walked with that ball. Well, I think he anticipated he had somebody to throw it to, and there was nobody there.
Actually, his father traveled a lot, too. They just didn't call it.
Like father, like son.
Yeah, exactly. So he's a little bit too far off from underneath the basket on that one.
Sean Taylor, Yusef Baker. Rebound by Alex Castillo. That's Castellano, I'm sorry.
Oh, way short.
Andrew shot that one, missed. Got a block call. There's a little bit of that fatigue we were talking about.
Just right.
They don't have their legs up on them right now, but I think probably when we get in the second half, it should pick up. But you gotta be careful because it's a 5-2 lead right now.
5 minutes and
15. Five minutes into the first quarter.
Championship game.
Here at the Downtown Rec in sunny Orlando, town of Mickey Mouse.
All right.
Dominique Jones shooting 2, missed his first one, coming back for the second shot.
Speaking of sunny Florida, you know, you just recently left California, right?
Oh, yes, I did. Made basket. Dominique makes his basket. Got a 6-2 lead in the first quarter. I loved it out there. Looking forward to going back.
My favorite city out there is San Diego.
Yes. UCF, nice outlet to Sean. Nice basket. Nice outlet. Got that ball. Hey, it's been proven you can pass that ball up the floor a heck of a lot faster than you can dribble it.
That is very true.
blocking foul.
Aggressively going to the basket.
I think that's going to be one of the keys. Now, both teams have short benches, so foul trouble is going to be an issue. But at the same time, the aggressiveness to the basket is going to cause some people to back off in fear of getting that extra foul, which ought to make getting to the basket. Oh, nice idea. Nice idea. Very nice idea. Here we go. Team loyalty coming in. 8-2.
Now, Vince, if there was anything that you would like to see happen as far as the Pro-Am, what is it that you would like to see if there's any changes that would be made? What is it?
More teams would be number one. This year was the least amount of teams we've had. Like to see a little bit more local participation from the community, some of the businesses and the local NBA team. We'd love to have them involved. Blocking call there.
And you would like to have more of the game streamed live?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
We'd like to have more game streamed. We'd love to. That's the participation from the community.
Right.
That would come in and help stream this and have some live TV when the opportunity presents itself.
Okay.
Alex got a nice situation and missed his first. Head coach Warren over there. And Billy's on the other side, three-time champion, makes that second basket.
8-3 game.
Nice move inside. Oh, nice recovery, nice putback.
Somebody not blocking out.
Bobby Brown played in JUCO in South Florida.
I remember Bobby Brown from last year.
Yeah, and there's Sean again. Oh, nice move on Ewing. Going for the alley-oop.
Oh, stepped out of bounds.
It's amazing, as big as this court is sometimes, it seems so short. you think the sidelines moves at times.
Oh, that's an old joke that the coach used to tell us when we would fall and say, yeah, you tripped on the line, right?
Tripped on the line. Nice move there. Nice move by Andrew.
It's a 10-5 game. 4 minutes to go here in the first quarter.
Starting to look a little bit more competitive now. I think they're getting their feet up on them.
Nice.
Nice move by Mr. Brown. Mr. Bobby Brown. Nice move.
It's his prerogative.
It was his prerogative. He took full advantage of it.
Ooh.
Oh, nice shot by B. Rich.
No, he got to call that one.
Yeah.
He got to call bank when he shoots from out there like that.
Nice look.
Yeah, it was. 12.
Needed basket, too.
Yeah, 12-8. Oh, wow.
Oh, nice from Sean. Nice is it from Sean to Bobby Brown. This is Kyle with the basketball. Giving it off to Alex. Nice screen set there by Andrew. Little Sean couldn't see around him. Nice give and go. Got a kick there. Nice idea. Mandatory timeout.
With 3 minutes and 16 seconds to go here in the first quarter. 14 seconds on the shot clock.
And we've got a 14-8 game. Your team loyalty up by 14-8. We have also like to take an opportunity to announce that the Midnight Basketball program will be having its 7th annual Hall of Fame event coming up in September 14th at Rose and Shingle Creek. Our speaker this year will be Coach Steve Ritter from Emory Ritter. Dynamic guy. I had an opportunity to hear him. He really speaks very strongly to the game of basketball as a coach, and we're looking forward to having an induction of some Hall of Famers this year. Harris Rosen, it will be our champion award. We will have Dr. Stephen Brooks, attorney Scott Seifer, and a longtime supporter, Mars DeBarge of the Midnight Basketball and the Center for Drug-Free Living. We would invite you all to come out September 14th at 5 p.m. At Rose and Shingle Creek. More information to be forwarded later. In fact, we'll put it up on your website.
Okay, but yeah, I was going to ask you about the website where people should be able to find out more information about Midnight Basketball.
Well, we have a OrlandoProAm.com where they can go and find out about the Pro-Am.
Right.
And we put this year's schedules was up on there. We have a tribute to a young man who played with us who passed away last year.
Oh, wow.
Richard Millsap.
Okay.
And we're honoring him this year by the championship trophies in his honor. And the players are wearing on their jersey the number 2, his number.
All right, that was the turnover there.
Big supporter of ours.
That was the turnover there. Patrick Ewing Jr. was camping out in the 3-second lane.
He does a lot of that. Dominique against B. Rich.
Short.
Oh. Out of bounds, out of bounds.
Oh, Mr. Jones shot an air ball.
I'm surprised. I really am. But you know what?
Maybe he's tired.
He might be a little tired. Also, I think he's probably trying to get his playing legs back up under him. End of the game now, number 4. That's Joey Rodriguez.
Whoa. Welcome to the block party.
Joey played professionally in Puerto Rico. Joey went to Lake Howell and also played at UConn. Virginia Commonwealth.
Okay.
And he made it to the Final Four team.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Local favorite from the area.
16 to 8 with 2 minutes to go here in the first quarter.
Patrick Ewing. Ooh, nice look. We're down to 1:55 left in the first quarter. Ball in the hands of Dominique. Rebound by Paul Lofer. Lopes. Oh, B. Rich on a nice look. Gets the second chance. There's that long rebound we talk about all the time. Fouled by Bobby Brown. That's that stuff that long tell players all the time when you're taking that shot, especially that long shot. Follow your shot. You get that long rebound.
Do have a bad habit of just watching your shot a lot of times.
Absolutely. We got an old-time favorite in the game. I know he wouldn't mind me saying Travis Mosley, number 6 for Team Lauder. He's been around the Pro-Am for a long time. Been on the last 3 championship teams.
Right.
He told me last year he was through playing, but I see that's not true.
And
his last game, the game before the semifinals, was that he played an excellent game. Passed the ball very well, got all his teammates involved. That's contributed to them being here in the championship game.
All right. Nice to see number 11 just made a power move. Not sure his name.
Paul.
Paul. Okay. Yeah, he just made a nice power move to the basket. Came short on the first three throw, but made the second. A 16-9 game.
Paul played at Texas Tech.
Okay.
When Pat Knight was there, Bobby Knight's son. There's Trapp. Nice look. He's back on. Nice looking shot there. Put this game at 19-9. 1 minute left. Boy, it looked like he walked on that, didn't it? Nice move by Paul there. Right. Certainly looked like he walked a little bit on that, but I don't know. Maybe this is NBA, right?
Oh, missed the bunny.
Oh, man. Nice look there by Sean. Oh, I'm sorry. That was Dwayne.
The court moved again.
Moved it. Well, that line will not stay still. All right, subbing into the game now for 3 stripes. Got another. They got a sub in there. They put Alex out. Gonna try to hold. We got 14 seconds on the shot clock. 35 seconds on the game clock. He went for the and one. Adam Allen, number 10's in the game now. Ball in his hand, takes his shot. Just misses a little bit. Dominique with the rebound. Now we've got shot clocks off. We're at about 8 seconds left in the first quarter. Dominique takes a shot. All right, there you have it. End of the first quarter of the 2014 Pro-Am Summer League is 19-11. Team loyalty is up over three strikes.
Yeah. I think they're going to have to make some of that outside shots in order to stay in this game.
Yeah, you know, we were talking about this the other day, and I find it very important that we don't see we see an awful lot of outside shooting, and we don't see a lot of post play driving to the basket. I think that's a symptomatic of what the league is like. You don't have any real true big guys coming out. We got these flex fours,
the
stretch fours.
The thing is, Vince, I don't think we're ever going to see a dominant big man ever again. I just don't think it's going to happen, because the mindset in these kids is all flashy and trying to be cool and is trying to have handles outside. You know, you're 6'11", trying to have handles. That game of Akeem Olajuwon, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Champ, that game seemed to be gone.
It's interesting. I've had an opportunity to speak with several NBA coaches, scouts, and they have a similar feeling that the true big man that we once knew, we're not going to see him anymore. And a lot, because what you have now, a lot of 7-foot guys, they are stretch fours. They might be playing the five, but they really don't play with their back to the basket. So I think
right.
You might be right. I miss that though. I like that big guy. All right, we're coming down here. Second quarter, Kyle with the ball.
That was always money in the bank.
I always thought so. There's big going inside to Paul. Paul makes a nice move.
See?
Nice.
That's what we're talking about right there.
Pat Knight would be really excited about that. There's Trapp with his shot.
Good
Mr.
rebound.
Brown. Nice rebound. Dwayne. Nice move. Oh, nice assist. That's what I like right
yeah.
there. Attack
there
that rack.
Right.
Attack that rack. I think second quarter we're starting to see they're waking up now. Paul against Bobby Brown. Oh, look at that. Nice
hustle play. Hustle play.
That's Adam Allen. Milton High School, played at Rollins College.
Oh, good block.
Oh, and he come back to make a block. Good shot.
Oh, block party.
That was a bad pass.
You're
turnover.
Right.
That's a charge. That's
yes,
he's inside
it is.
The circle.
Yes, it is.
Guaranteed. That's a no. And I like that too. That takes the guess out of it.
Right. 21-15. Early second quarter. This is the championship game here in Orlando, the Pro-Am.
Downtown Rick. History. History right here in this building. Nice, very nice move. Nice move by Kyle Matthews. Nice job, Kyle. Sean with the ball. Passing it back to Dwayne. He's looking. Oh, nice. Oh, I thought he was going to take that to the
right.
Rack.
Right, because he was open. Off.
All right, you got that ball. That was Adam. Paul took that ball, gave it to Ewing. Nice to Alex. Nice alley-oop to Alex Castillo.
It's a two-point ball game.
Here it comes.
And I think the momentum started to swing once they started attacking the basket.
I 100% agree with that. I always think that the game, that's when you want to have a momentum change. A lot of people say it's a three-point shot, but I think it's when you attack the basket. Turnover for Mr. Brown. When you attack that basket, that other player has to respect that. He's got to play defense now.
And then, I don't know, Vince, whether or not you had that conversation about what they should be eating between meals. You know, like I mean, in between games as far as, the fruit and,
yes.
You know, staying away from the fries and, like, past the McDonald's. You know,
I should have held a team meeting. Let's discuss this, fellas.
You know, you got to play more than one game.
You got to play. That's right. Nice look. Nice screen. Good matchup. Dominique Jones against Patrick Ewing. Ewing misses. Bobby Brown with the rebound. Kicks it out to Dwayne. All the way to Mr. Jones. Trap Mosley with the ball. Give it back to Yusef Baker.
All right.
Former Evans High School player. UCF played at Evans and also went to University of South Florida. Played overseas a little bit also.
Okay.
Turned out to be a good foul.
Got
6 minutes and 11 seconds. Two-point right. ball game.
Yeah, two-point ball game. UCF misses both shots. Rebound by Patrick Ewing. There's a case of that big guy that does not play with his back to the basket. Oh, nice steal. Attack. Good job.
I got a problem with the ball being stolen from you and you didn't cross half court.
Two times we had a kick ball.
Yeah. I got a problem with that. The ball stolen from you and you didn't cross half court.
Oh, yeah.
Standing there looking at the official to bail you out.
Yeah, when to bail you out and give you that call. You got to earn that call. You got to earn them. Kyle with the basketball. Nice inside pitch to Ewing, guarded by Dominique Jones. Brown coming on the Nice job by Alex. Oh, I thought he made that.
All right.
He's been making some of those kind of in traffic shots too.
Yeah. Nice cut. Five 28, 23 to 19. Second quarter.
The end of another great Pro-Am summer.
Mark it down.
Some very good games have been played this summer. Oh. Interesting, on three stripes, Joey Rodriguez appears to be through for the night. See, he's got ice on his foot, shoes off. He might be down for the night. Former VCU player. Played at, Joey also played at, he was a Lake Highland, played in the Final Four with VCU.
Oh, yeah.
I see him sitting on the bench. He might be finished. Free throw shooting. UCF misses another one. Make the free throws, changes the game.
That's true.
3-point game. That was just ugly.
Oh, okay. I'm glad you said that because I was thinking the same thing.
Nice rebound by Jones.
I was thinking it, and you said it.
It is amazing how still at any level that free throw is still a critical shot. Nice rebound by B. Rich. Kicks it out. Kyle with the ball. Alex. In his comfort zone, nice pass. Oh, missed that pass. That was Adam Allen. Nice drive. He was in the right position.
Yeah.
Just could hold on to the ball. A little bit more patient. Looking for that inside game. Ball movement. Oh, got it. Shot clock didn't. I think we got a shot clock didn't move. We are looking at an adjustment on the shot clock down to 8 seconds. 8 seconds. 23 to 20. Got to put it up. Got to put it up. Mr. Foreman come through with a critical shot just before the shot clock goes off.
That was
a
three.
That's pressure basketball right there.
Kind of easy like Sunday morning.
Nice look.
Timeout.
Got a timeout. Here we are in Orlando, Florida, the Downtown Recreation Center. Championship game of the 2014 Pro-Am.
You know, why don't you give us a little history on the Downtown Rec, because you see the magic logo in the center of the court.
Isn't that this year, when the Magic first came to Orlando, this was their practice facility.
Yes, it was.
And the Downtown Rec had a strong history in the community at Davis Armory.
Right.
Back in the day. And when I first moved here, there were two places they were playing basketball. Was the Downtown Recreation and the J.R. Smith Center. If you could play, that's where you went to see. If you want to see some good basketball with these two locations. The Magic came in and spent a few dollars.
All right.
As you can see, it's in Magic colors and have their logo there. And then, of course, things got better and they moved out.
All right.
But the city maintained the support for the Magic and left the court as it is. Great NBA court, lined up just right. Great place to play ball.
Right. I've actually have held a couple of events here myself, you know. I think my second year of my anti-drug karate tournament youth summit was here.
Mm-hmm. Yes. There's a lot of history here.
Right.
Three Stripes comes in today with an 8-6 record, and I believe Team Larger comes in with a 9-5 record.
They used to hold the City of Orlando cheerleading competition here too, for 4 years. That was a big event once upon a time here.
I've heard about that.
Nice.
Trap did a good job, but Alex got that ball in. Nice post move, a little to the back basket play there. Nice inside look, nice. Alex, didn't look like a foul, but
defensive
situation there.
Actually, it looks like Bobby Brown may have used the forearm to, push him off a little bit, and that was why he was struggling, because he was trying to get around that forearm.
Once again, we yield to the officials. He was standing there. I think he had a better angle at it.
Oh, charge.
Yes.
Oh, well.
Yes. Got charged.
Yeah, well, actually, that might have been a makeup call, too, but that's okay.
Yeah, it could have been. You're right about that. It could have been a makeup call. Very possible. Got Sean Taylor back on the floor, Jones High School, Brevard Community College. Balls in to miss.
Oh,
to
good block.
Got a block. Dominique Jones coming down. Bad pass.
Turnover.
Another turnover.
3:24 to go in the second quarter. 26-22.
Got an official's timeout here. We got a little moisture on the floor. Team Larger is coached by Billy, our local favorite Billy Williams, I think Billy's last name is. He's been around for the last several years, done a great job with his program, and they won three championships.
All right.
We got Juan Burnell over there, Brian Pink, and Austin Davis, assistant coaches, working with Juan for the Three Stripes. Nice hit by Kyle. Bobby Brown against Andrew. Nice turnover.
Ooh. All right, you got the numbers.
One.
You got the numbers. Oh!
And he got blocked.
Whoa, my goodness.
Outstanding play by Mr. Brown.
Oh, my goodness.
Mr. Jones tried to get it. Gonna try it again. Try it a second time. Good shot. Got two opportunities to make that down. 29-25, 2:23 left in the second quarter. 17 seconds on the top of the shot clock.
Did you tell the big man that he's being seen all around the world? Because he made him look like a little boy on that play.
Yes, he did. And they had a 3-on-1
right.
And came away with a blocked shot. B. Rich with a last second shot before the shot clock. Dwayne Former bringing the ball down. Under 2 minutes. Bobby Brown with a shot. Ooh, in and out. Andrew with the rebound. B. Rich. Oh, nice look there. We got a minute 33. Mr. Jones, there he is, three-pointer. Well, we got a 32.
Make it look easy.
Got a timeout?
Yes.
1 minute, 26 seconds, 32-25.
Team
Lardo with three stripes in the Orlando Pro-Am Championship game here in Orlando, Florida. When we were talking with Eli Rowe earlier, he was mentioning about the opportunity for a lot of these officials to get to come out and have an opportunity to work on their game at this level of play.
Right.
I think a lot of times people don't are not aware that the Pro-Am serves more than one purpose. It's not just for the athletes, the players per se, but it helps the officials to come out and hone their skills as well. They get a chance to officiate games, work with men, grown men, and learn the NBA mechanics. That's one of the things I'm excited about. This does so much for the community. They get to see high-level talent, high-level officiating, and some excellent play. Here we go, going in 1 minute and 26 seconds left. Three strikes, bring it in. Be Rich with the ball. Inside Patrick Ewing against Yusef Baker. He got away with it. Yusef got away with what looks like could have been a foul. I watched that and I didn't believe it. Nice shot by Dominique. Don't know how he got that ball to go down, but here we are with 57.5 seconds left, 0.6 seconds left before halftime. Score is 34-25. Team Loyalty is ahead. Nice. Oh, fantastic. Fantastic hustle by Yusef Baker.
Patrick.
Oh, Alex, nice drive, but Mr. Brown took that away from him.
Actually, he's made a couple of nice blocks.
Yes, he has. Kyle passed Matthews to Alex. Nice drive. Oh, got away with it. Kyle, back to Alex. Now Patrick Ewing Jr. He gets that
the shooter's touch.
Shooter's touch. Look.
Yeah, that's a nice way of putting it.
Mr. Foreman, Andrew's going for the long shot. Oh, that looks good. Here we are at the end of the first half, 34-28. Team Loyalty is ahead of three stripes.
Well, you know, Vince, the funny thing is that it's the reason why they're down as many as they are because it's the little things. They had, I think, three opportunities where they had numbers on the break. And Bobby Brown came up with a couple of nice blocks, but there was also a couple of key turnovers too as well.
It is that is probably the recipe for a lot of teams is the small details. Free throw shooting and turnovers. And turn the ball over at the most crucial time. Ball possession is everything. And I agree that a couple of free throws here, turnovers, we got a different game.
Yeah, I was kind of taken away at some of the easy blocks that basically the big man put himself in position. They were easy blocks.
Yeah, well, yeah, because a lot of times, yes, and if we make these shots, we drive them to the basket, we put a lot of pressure on the big guys. Now you got to move those feet, you got to get his body in the right position, as opposed to just standing there waiting for you to come up and do that. You make him move, and I think that's been an important part of what has happened as well. Missed shots. There's no substitution for a made shot.
Okay, let me ask you, what you think going to take place in the second half? You know, pull out your magic wand, pull out your crystal ball, put some new batteries in it, give me something what you think going to happen in the second half.
One of the things I think you're going to see in the second half is I think three stripes are going to be they're going to try to slow the game down a little bit and try to be deliberate and disciplined and try to walk this lead down like they did in the last game. On the other side, I think what you're going to see from Team Larger, they're going to try. Mr. Jones is going to become more dominant. He's the X factor for three strikes. If they can stop Mr. Jones, they got a chance to win. Now, the other players contributed, but he's a dominant factor. So I think you're going to see more of him starting in the third quarter, and Ewing. Now, if Ewing can get his outside game going, we could see a different. But I think typically the way that three strikes operate right now, they're going to be more methodical. They're going to be more disciplined, and they're going to try to take it one play at a time.
Okay, now I don't know much about Patrick Ewing Jr. You said something about his outside shot, so he's an outside shooter.
Yes. When I first observed his play, I was shocked. He never really went down to the back. He is not his dad.
Okay,
that is for sure. And he's a different. He has a different kind of game because he's a face the basket type player. He shoots the ball reasonably well.
Uh-huh.
He attacks the basket. Occasionally he'll post up, but he's gonna turn around and face you.
Okay.
He's not gonna dominate you to the basket.
Okay. How tall is he?
About 6'11", I believe.
Really?
I think he's 6'11".
Wow. Okay. You know, well, I mean, and all reasons that I say wow is because I have to remember the sign of the times now.
Yes. You got the Dirk Nowitzkis, Paul Gasol.
Right. And the idea of you being 6'11 and you playing outside is just, that's weird to me. You know, and that's just weird.
That is different from what I know.
Right. So, and nothing against him. I'm just saying it's a sign of the times. Understanding that you're 6'11", you should be dominating the paint, period.
You know,
ain't no ands, ain't no ifs. You 6'11", you should be dominating the paint.
I was up in Atlanta during the coaching college coaches live period in a situation called Play the Best of the South.
Uh-huh.
I can't tell you how many big guys I saw handling the basketball, running what looked like a point situation and shooting, but we had one or two teams with the guys that played with their back to the basket. It's a little strange to see, but
I know. It's,
sometimes you see those guys play, you understand why they got the ball in their hands, though.
Here
we go, second half, 34-28, ball in the hands of three strikes. We'll start out with the ball. Kyle passing in to Ewing. Ooh, nice back door. Adam tried to, Paul tried to come in and clean that up, but it was too late.
Yeah.
We'll see what loyalty has in his bag of tricks. Got a mismatch right off the bat. Nice defense by Ewing.
Yeah, actually, yeah, that was. And actually, that was good defense on that series.
Yes.
Bad pass, though.
Yeah, well, it would have helped if he had just caught it.
Oh, boy. You know, sometimes as coaches, you know, it'd be like, well, guys, I'm really not supposed to have all this gray hair. You know that, right? you know, really.
Three stripes look a little bit out of sync, as well as does loyalty and what they want to do with the basketball.
Trying to isolate Ewing. Oh.
This is starting to look. I'm going to give him a couple of more minutes here and see if they can get. Because this is starting to look a little out of sync.
Took his eyes off the ball.
Yes. Trying to do more with it. You got to catch it first, Coach always says.
Right.
Nice move. He had a clear lane, though. He had a very good lane. Got through there. Foul was on number 11.
I'm reminiscing now, and I'm trying to imagine that lane open up the way that it did, and if that was the doctor.
That would be a highlight film. That for sure would be a highlight film. That would, without a shadow of a doubt, be a highlight. You'd be a posterized. Former knocks down two. We got a 36-28 ball game. 7:32 left in the third quarter. Kyle bringing the ball down with 15 seconds on the shot clock. Got Bobby Brown on a foul, on a holding foul. Kyle with the basketball. Looking at Ewing. Oh, over to Paul. Adam. Dwayne Foreman with a rebound and a foul on Patrick Ewing. Eighteen seconds left on the shot clock. Dominic Jones, a little off tonight. Got a three on one. Ewing off a rebound. Looked like a charge to me, but
You
got the basket. I actually thought he charged on that. That's why I'm up here and the officials are down there. So.
6-point ball game.
It appears as though the strategy of three stripes, you know, being patient, disciplined, playing good defense. Got a loose ball foul. Number 11, that's Paul Looper. Paul played at Texas Tech under Pat Knight. Yusef Baker back to Dwayne. You got Adam out. Oh, Yusef, ball off of Yusef. Yep, that's a turnover.
All right. They can pull within two or they can pull within three. I'm sorry, they can pull within four or they can pull within three.
The ball movement. Got in the paint. Mr. Foreman shooting this. Whoa. Nice look. 9-point game. Patrick Ewing with the ball. And
righty
one.
Then. Talking about the big man going to the basket. Tell him to say, see, good things happens when you go to the basket.
Good things happen when you get to the basket.
You know, I can see him. Gonna be like my daddy. Gonna be like my daddy.
Good. That's got to be quite a burden. We got a 6-point ball game, but that's got to be quite a burden to try to be,
right.
be named after your dad.
All right.
Then get in the league and have to play like your dad. We'll play with the same intensity as your dad. That's got to be tough.
But I'm pretty sure he's used to it. He's been hearing it all his life.
All his life. He's been playing over in Greece, or he was last year. Mr. Brown, nice opportunity. 8-point ball game. 5:05 in the third.
Oh, good push.
Nice push. Alex got the basket. Nice shove. Mr. Brown, a little off. Alex with a rebound.
Here we go.
A Very good defense. I thought Brown played very good defense on Ewing that time, going, taking that lane away from him.
Good move. All right. Showing me something inside the paint, you know.
He's a big body now.
You know, I'm about to stand up and holler. Holler inside the paint.
We got a mandatory timeout here.
We're
third quarter, 4 minutes, 15 seconds, 21 seconds left on the clock.
Nothing like some good old basketball.
You can't beat it.
I'm saying.
41-37 ball game, 4-point game.
Be like, put on your hard hat and let's go to work. Look like one of your old Detroit Pistons. Did you see that documentary on the Bad Boys? Did you see that?
Yes. That's a good basketball. I wasn't necessarily a Detroit Pistons fan, but I had to respect what they did.
I used to love the Pistons.
I was a big Chuck Daly fan.
I used to love the Pistons because anybody that liked the Pistons, anybody like the Raiders, anybody like the Bears, they'd be sitting there talking. You know, as a matter of fact, I don't know if you remember this, but in one of those games, when they was playing against the Lakers, they went into overtime, and the Lakers did not score in overtime. They shut them down.
Boy, I don't remember that. but
they did not score in overtime.
That makes it that
the Pistons shut them down.
Well, I can believe that because what they did to Michael the first time, Michael up.
Well, Michael said it. Michael said mentally, physically, and emotionally, he was not prepared to play against them. And he said because of them and what he went through the experiences, because how he became
a
ball player.
Foul right. On Mr. Brown. An offensive Brown foul on Bobby Brown here.
Okay, they can come within two here. Four-point ball. Well, no, I'm sorry. I got my math all wrong. Was it six?
It's 4-point ball game.
Yeah. Okay.
Kyle against Dwayne. B. Rich, nice pass. I thought he traveled with that a little bit.
On the 10 on the shot clock.
Patrick against Brown.
Six seconds. Tough shot.
All right, we got Trap with the ball. Travis Mosley. I see one of the things I noticed right off the bat is that you have more movement from three stripes than you have from Lawyer. Yeah. Lawyer is standing around a little bit more.
Ooh.
See, that's what happens with this team.
Catch you sleeping.
That's what they do. They slow the pace down, they take advantage of opportunity, and then they hit those big shots. We got a 1-point game. Air ball. Mr. Brown covers it up.
Right.
Nice rebound by Travis Mosley.
You know, for people though who don't understand, they have no idea how much an air ball throws you off. It just throws you completely off.
Absolutely.
And it's the hardest thing to explain. You know, because it's all in the anticipation.
Yeah.
And then it just throws you off.
Be Rich, misses a basket. He normally makes. That's one of his signature moves. Travis Mosley and outside. He's 2-for-1.
Hustle play.
Got a block by Paul Looper on Travis Mosley. Coming in the game now for we got a timeout.
Yes.
Timeout by three strikes.
With 2 minutes and 20 seconds to go here in the third quarter.
19 seconds left on the shot clock.
What I mean by throwing you off is just offensively and defensively, because your anticipation and you're going for the rebound and you're so used to the ball hitting the rim, so when it falls short like that, it just throws everything off.
Yeah, it definitely does throw your rhythm off, because you're looking at trying to get, if you're a defensive ball player, you're looking for the ball to hit the rim so you get your defensive position.
Right.
Looking to get that bounce back. That ball is not. If you know, it's most of the time people just freeze.
Right.
They don't do anything. What happened? What has happened?
All right.
Okay, for team loyalty, they have number 6 is in the game. Oh, I'm sorry. Number 9. Number nine, that's Dre Andrew Wellington. Yeah, you gotta be careful leaving Mr. Jones open like that. Ooh, took a step. Some anticipation there from Mr. Wellington. Andre, call him Dre. We're under 2 minutes in the third. 3-point game. Rebound from Yusef Baker. Kick out to Mr. Jones. 1:46, 18 seconds on the shot clock. Mr. Mosley, trap with a nice athletic move to the basket. Got a 5-point game. 1:22 in the third. Be Rich, nice move. Nice strong move to the basket. Starting to heat up a little bit. 3-point game.
A minute to go here in the third quarter.
Ooh.
All right, you
got
numbers.
Two on one.
All right, you got numbers. Yay, finally.
Finally, we got it. We got a fast break, right?
Right, finally.
Got a 1-point game. Under 50 seconds, 19 on the shot clock, 45-44. Team Large is up and have the ball.
Oh, wow. That was a carry.
Very, very nicely done. Nice job by Trapp to Yusef Baker on an inside pass. Nice give and go. Mr. Ewing. Ball out of play. Ball out of play. 3-point game. Loyalty up 47-44. Got a brand new shot clock with 26.3 seconds left in the third quarter.
Now, if we were playing horse and I called that, would that be good?
In horse, it would be good. If you called it.
Okay. 12 on the shot clock. About a second difference between the shot clock and the game clock.
Got a foul. I think Mr. Jones was trying to get a shooting violation there. A foul, so he in the active shooting.
I wouldn't have fouled him. Why did he foul him?
Mistake.
It's like, why did he do that?
Mistake. he left him open. There we have it. We are one quarter away from establishing our 2014 Summer League Pro-Am champion. Right now it's 47-44, team loyalty over three stripes. We are about to go into the final quarter. This is the ticker tape. The tail of the game will be right here.
All right, now we're anticipating going into the locker room where the champagne is. Yeah. Just make sure that you cover yourself up. Don't get it in your eyes,
man. Don't get it in my
eyes. Yeah, yeah.
One of the things right here, the winner of this game to me comes out with more energy in the fourth quarter, coming out with a lot of energy and ball movement. I believe they win the game. Whoever can get that done.
Well, you know, there's an old saying. The saying is whoever makes the most shots, more than likely is going to win. But that always goes back to the shots that you take
and they got to go in.
Right, exactly.
You got
exactly.
The most made shots.
Right. Yeah. So we will see whether or not we will find out who was at Mickey D's in between games.
Yeah, absolutely. Because right about now, that grease is starting to kick in. It's hardening up. Here we go. Our 9 minutes to establish our champion for the year. The first annual Richard Millsap Championship Award and runner-up. Ball will be in the hands of Team Loyalty. Here we go. Three-point game, 47-44. See, that's what I'm saying. Nice shot, but Team Larch is standing around, waiting on one person. I think that could come back to hurt them. Hopefully not. A little bit more movement on three stripes. Good opportunity. Great opportunity.
You know, it's coming back to me now. Because I remember we were doing the game and the gentleman Millsap, and I think he played the game, and I think the following day something happened, and I think he was shot, and he...
The following Monday.
The following, yeah. Okay.
In fact, it was that, I think it was the following Monday after the game he played in.
Right. Okay. It's coming back to me now. Right.
It was a murder. He was,
right,
he
right.
was killed in sight.
It's coming back to me now.
Nice shot by Alex. We've got a one-point game. Really a great guy, lovely family. Family was very supportive of it. Our best still goes out to the family. And nice move, Mr. Brown. I think Andrew played a little Matador defense there.
Yeah, definitely. Might as well say ole.
Ole.
Ole, ole, ole.
Be Rich with the ball. Boy, he hit six in a row the other night, Be Rich did. Number 12 for three stripes.
Oh, there you
nice
go.
Nice back door. Oh. Nope, didn't get it off. Didn't get it off. Second guessed himself. All right, we got a 3 points. Back to a 3-point game. 49-46. Team Lawrence. A lot of one-on-one. That's their ball. But you see this standing around, difference being three stripes are moving more, getting more opportunities to get to the basket.
Right. Definitely.
Some of that might be fatigue, too. Nice.
Oh, good block.
Block shot by Ewing. What a heck of a matchup that is.
Come on now.
Nice.
There you go.
Alex and Andrew. Ball movement.
It's a 1-point ball game. 7 minutes to go.
This could be interesting. Very interesting.
Oh, what did he?
Almost. I thought he stepped out of bounds. Guess not. Three-pointer. Here we go, 52-48. One of the things, nice shot by Kyle. One of the things I can say is a lot of our games have been like this throughout the summer. Close games. Only had a couple games where they were, more double-digit leads. But I think this is good competition,
right.
Good to watch.
Uh-huh.
Ooh, Kyle lost it.
Lost it.
Yeah, good move to the basket, too. It is 52-48, 6:16, fourth quarter, Orlando Pro-Am Championship game here in Orlando, Florida, home of Mickey Mouse and Shamu.
Mm-hmm.
Wayne Foreman with the ball, attacking, threw it away, and got it up. No,
right.
He almost didn't get it.
Right.
Trying to create too much one-on-one. Got to get team involved, I think. But they have the lead right now. So. 550 left in the fourth.
Lost it on the way up.
He lost that ball. He had a good opportunity there. We got a 3-on-1. Little man makes it. Sean Taylor. 54. That was a silly foul. In a... Foul on Dwayne. We got 48 to 54. Nice ball movement. Good shot, Mr. Ewing. Nice looking shot, 51-54.
3-point ball game, 5 minutes to go.
I'm loving it.
Yeah.
5 minutes, here we go. 15 on the shot clock. Four seconds on the shot clock. Lost that. Turn it over.
I'm noticing because last year when I saw Jones play, he was a little bit more aggressive.
I truly believe that multiple game situation is having its toll. The good part about it is affects both teams.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I did expect a little bit more up-tempo in the second half, but we still got a good game here. Three-point game.
Yeah, yeah. With 4 minutes and 36 seconds to go here in the fourth quarter for the championship, a three-point ball game.
Ewing against Jones. Oh, nice. We got a two-on-two, three-on-two. Need to score. Nice by Mr. Foreman, Wayne Foreman. Nice opportunity there. Ewing lost his footing.
Right.
Nice trap. Good job. UCF Baker on Ewing's shot.
4 minutes to go.
I think Team Lodge is starting to be a little bit more deliberate now, using more of the shot clock.
Here we go.
Mr. Jones. And Mr. Baker. Oh. Sean saved it back to Trap. Nice basket, Trap. Oh. Got him off his feet.
Yep.
All right. Nice Trap. That's Kyle. Matthew. Oh. Ewing on the rebound. And he got a foul.
Timeout.
Got a mandatory timeout. Here we go into
326. 58. 51.
It's starting to heat up a little bit now. I'm starting to see a little bit more on both sides. Now you get hungry.
Yeah.
Now we're hungry. So. Now it's time to get hungry. Trying to see who wants it the most. Who's gonna have now that burst of energy comes out now. I see Joey Rodriguez is out of uniform, so he is not playing anymore tonight. We are at 326, 58, 51. The defending champs ahead by 7. With 326 left in the fourth quarter, and we're shooting, I think we got some free throws.
Yes.
A nice crowd here at the Downtown Rec to see this final game for our Pro-Am season. We're really excited about it. Closing out, but also starting to start talking about next year.
When do you start preparing for next season?
Actually, we start about December.
Okay.
Start working on it. The beginning stages in January, we start putting we have the planning session in December. Two shots by Mr. Ewing, 53-58. And then we really kind of crank it up around February.
Okay.
Nice defense by you and your corner. Mr. Brown in a good position. Oh, been nice if you could have made that basket. That foul was on Paul Looper. Paul Looper played 4 years at Texas Tech.
How tall is he, do you know?
Don't have an actual number, but he's a big guy.
Yeah.
Mr. Brown, missed the first of two shots. He gets his second opportunity here. He makes it. We got a 6-point ball game. Kyle and Sean have been going at it pretty strong tonight. I like, so it's been some good defensive ball playing there. Got a mismatch. Alex on him. Nice flop. Oh, beautiful. Nice yes. Way to control himself. Alex, excellent basket there. 4-point game. 18 seconds up on the shot clock. 2:42 in the half, in the quarter.
Oh, help. There you go. All right.
Turnover.
2 minutes and 28 seconds.
I got a turnover going. Yusef Baker coming back in the game. They're going to take Sean Taylor out. They got a little bit more size to match up. That's pretty good matchup on the floor now. You got Brown on Paul. You got Baker on Ewing. Yeah,
he got him.
Yeah, he really did. That was UCF foul. Shooting two with a 4-point game. Could be looking at overtime.
Oh, okay. We already see him, you know, leaning. See with the hands on the knees?
Yep.
I know that feeling.
Do I ever. I had that feeling this morning in the gym.
Yeah, definitely know that feeling.
Ewing makes one out of two. It's a 3-point game.
A foul.
Kyle.
Yeah. They're doing the Hacker Shack.
Kyle is from Masters Academy. First team, his senior year. No, I didn't see that one. What happened?
They doing the Hacker Shack.
Oh, doing the Hacker Shack. Okay.
Yeah. They trying to put him on the line.
Got another one. Well, what are we?
Trying to put the gentleman over there who has the ball on the line.
Oh, Mr. Youssef.
Yeah.
Youssef Baker. Well, it's not a bad move. Mr. Baker has not been known for his free throw shooting.
Oh. Now they're taking him out of the game.
That's a good move. Two minutes, 10 seconds, 21 seconds on the clock. Ball in Dominique Jones' hands, guarded by Alex. You would not. This would be a good place to have the ball. Don't want to foul him. Good shot. 6-point ball game. 5-point ball game. Alex on Dwayne. Oh, Dominique come over and smacked it away. Got it. turnover.
Okay, now Mr. Jones is going to try to take over.
Now, here we go. We're down to 1 minute, 20 seconds. 5 on the shot clock. Shot clock violation. Referees are going to have to sort this out.
Yeah.
Oh, he did get a rebound.
Yeah.
He did get a rebound.
It did hit the rim.
It did get the rebound.
It tipped it.
It must have just barely, because for me, it looked like it didn't hit at all.
It did. It did. They come over and look at the replay, you know, if they want to.
All right, you got 1 minute. Here we go. We're under a minute. 10 seconds on the shot clock. 5-point game. Mr. Brown. Rebound by Paul Looper. Ball in Ewing's hand. Ewing came up with a big shot the last game.
That was a very bad shot.
Yeah, that was not a good calculation. Oh, he got away. Looper got him. That was a bad shot.
And see, honestly, Vince, I've seen over the last maybe 7, 8, 9 years. Because of the, I would call the new generation of ball players, whether or not it's pros or college that have set into that three-point shooting mindset.
Mm-hmm. Mindset, yep.
I've seen opportunities that that they didn't take advantage of because they're so into now taking the three-point shot that they don't know anything about how to go to the basket, make something happen, and that they think they have to do it now when there's plenty of time on the clock to do what needs to be done.
Yeah, I agree. I think they added a three-point shot to add a little bit more flavor to the game, which I agree that it did. But sometimes it's just a lazy way out. You pull up and shoot three rather than attack the basket, which I'm still believing you got to attack that basket. Be Rich, ball off, black ball, still black ball. 22.5 seconds. It looks like Team Loyalty is going to pull it out again. 63-56. 22.5 seconds left. This is going to be a history in the program. 4 years in a row. 4 times a champion. Be Rich. Be Rich is going cold this game. Dominique Jones won a three. 66, 10-point game, 7.4 seconds. They pulled it off again. Here you go. There it is. Your champions for 2014 Summer League will be Team Loyalty. They beat Three Stripes again from last year. They beat them again this year.
Okay. Well, next year we will again be here to televise the game.
Televise again.
And we will see, you know. But what did you think of the second half?
Second half was a little bit slower than I thought it was. Didn't see the same energy. But I also thought that Team Three Stripes gambled a little more than I thought they would. On the offensive side of the ball, they tried to look like they relied a little bit more on their three. Didn't take full advantage of their inside opportunities, in my opinion.
Right.
Loyalty was standing still in late in the second half, early in the third or fourth quarter, they had more movement than you had from Team Three Stripes.
Okay. All right, well, we're going to sign it off. You know, you guys did a great job with the program itself. And I know you're looking forward. You said that you will start again. You start picking up around January.
Start again in next June 2015, Lord willing. We'll be at it again next year.
Okay, and why don't you talk more about the Midnight Basketball Annual Dinner?
The Midnight Basketball Hall of Fame will take place on September the 14th at Rosen Shingle Creek, starting at 5. We're looking for, this is a fundraiser for Midnight Basketball, which helps support the Pro-Am.
Mm-hmm.
And our guest speaker this year will be Coach Steve Ritter from Embry-Riddle. And we will be inducting Mars LaBarge, Dr. Brooks, attorney Scott Seifert, and Harris Rosen into our Hall of Fame for Midnight Basketball.
Well, now, I know what it's about, but for those that out there that don't really know what it's about and would like to find out more information, or do you take donations, or...
Absolutely. We ticket sales, and we also have a silent auction. So they have the ability to come and bid on the item, which helps us a lot.
Right.
If they would like to make a donation, you can contact my office at 407-245-0010, extension 245, mm-hmm. and we'll make arrangement to accept your donation from you.
Okay.
If you want to come out and just do it at the auction.
Well, what I mean by that is like, for an example, somebody may be watching this like 3 months from now, but this is an annual event, and they would like to find out more information because this goes on every year, and it's always probably in the month of September.
Yes.
So I was just saying.
They can contact my office again, 407-245-0010, extension 245, and we can provide for them the information they may require,
okay.
or make contact with them as a reference to supporting it.
Right.
Because we have other events that go on throughout the year, but that's our big one.
Okay.
Because we get a chance to talk to the community, thank the community for their support, mm-hmm. and we'd love to have them come out and join us.
And tell us more about what Midnight Basketball does and the history of it, because this is going into, what, to its 20th?
23rd year.
Yeah.
This is our 23rd year that we've been in the community, that we help to provide an opportunity for kids and young adults to come out in a safe environment, to build relationships, and play basketball as an alternative for being out in the street. We've been able to service, last year we serviced 70,000 kids. That was just a weekend program. We were in four counties, but we're now down to one county, five locations here in Orlando. We're at this facility, the Downtown Rec, on Saturday nights. We're at Dover Shores on Friday nights. We're at Winter Garden on Friday nights. We're at the Winter Park Community Center on Saturday. Here at the Downtown Rec on Saturday and Inglewood Community Center.
Now,
it's free to the public.
Right. But at the same time, Vince, the reason why I'm trying to get you to give the information out, because the success of this program that you even mentioned in the different counties here in this area, in case people would like to come and mirror what you're doing, because you make a difference in the community and you touch the lives of thousands of young people and as well as parents.
Yeah, yes, that's true. We've been very fortunate enough to hear from several parents who said to us how important the program has been. So we're offering any opportunity for people who would love to get more about what we do to contact us. You can contact us through the Pro-Am website, which is OrlandoProAm.com, www.OrlandoProAm.com. We have an information section on there. If you desire some information, you can leave a message there and we'll get back to you. Or again, you can call my office at 407-245-0010, extension 245, and we can provide additional information for you.
Okay, well, go ahead and give us the final score of today's game, and we can get out of here.
All right, here we go. It was 66-56. Team Lardy wins the championship again. It defends its championship against Three Stripes. And here we are in Orlando, Florida, 2014 Pro-Am. We are going home. Thank you for joining us, and good night.